Hello, sir. This is our first ever recorded conversation. We are here to speak about the challenges first generation lawyers feel and how young lawyers should go about building their practice. This is a brief introduction that I have prepared for a person I have admired for a long period of time. Senior Advocate Sanjoy Ghosh graduated from NLSIU in 1996. He has been a junior to Senior Advocate Indira Jaisingh and also Rajiv Agarwal. Initially, he has started his professional journey in labor law and service law matters, but he now has an expansive practice across tribunals in the high courts and, of course, the Supreme Court. He also deals with dispute resolution in the form of arbitration, etc., etc. He has been a standing counsel for Government of NCT of Delhi for a long time. He is, of course, now a senior advocate. A small personal story I would actually like to add over and above everything that I have said here is I have actually worked with Mr. Ghosh for a short period of time as a fresher. Mr. Ghosh may not be aware of this fact, but he has actually been a true first mentor in my life. I had Googled the best possible litigation offices or chambers to join for a law student to be a professional and simply to get some work, basically, and learn and be at least something like paid for it in some manner. I wanted to learn about the art of litigation from someone who was deeply embedded and practicing in courts, had a long list of matters, a cause list, etc., etc. So one thing led to another, and I found his phone number, and eventually I landed up at Mr. Ghosh's office for an interview. So I feel a little naive and relatively stupid in hindsight as a law student, and remember specifically telling him that I could not find anything on Google about him. However, through my own research, I felt like this was the office I needed to be at, and that I would work with or without pay, that I just wanted to learn. But of course, I was hoping that he would pay, and he did. And maybe he saw someone who was fairly pure and honest, but I was hired and asked to come in from the next working day for whatever reason. Now, I actually could only survive for 3 months, as I found the experience to be exactly what I had wanted, which was lots of cases actually assigned to me from the very beginning. To be completely honest, this level of accountability, including client management, having a cause list of over 20, 30 cases a day, running around the Delhi High Court and other courts and tribunals, being fully in charge of briefing and drafting, including some high-profile matters, others even pro bono matters, just came to me as a reality check, to be very honest. And I needed to reconsider whether I could do litigation at all at that point of time. When it came to the first 3 months of professional life, accordingly, it was completely different from the toughest internships that I had done all through law school, which seemed like were preparing me for something that I probably had no idea about at that time. Through this brief period of time, I remember Mr. Ghosh telling me I needed to find a passion, that it should not be person or alcohol, etc., or anything else that kids these days romanticize about. He was relentless actually in trying to teach me what needed to be done, whether it was right in the middle of court or back in office or even calling me home or on phone calls. And that is, I think, how what he has done for all his juniors, whether they stay for a short period of time or a long period of time. I feel thankful for having gone through the experience, which at that time seemed very tough. But in hindsight, again, was probably the biggest learning and probably the biggest lost chance to truly be a litigator. But that's okay. For me, that is who Mr. Sanjoy Ghosh is, a true mentor, a great human being, a stern but jovial person, charming with a razor-sharp intellect and astute as all lawyers should be, someone young lawyers should actually learn from. Our guest of honor has a unique and peculiar practice of reading books in the corridors of courts. The importance of endlessly and constantly reading is something that gets reinforced again and again when you are around Mr. Ghosh. So this is actually slightly off topic, sir, but I would actually try like to ask this question before we can actually commence. How can you manage to read so much, and how does it really help, and what should lawyers actually read about?
Well, thank you, Tushar, for that rather extensive confession. And I will use that in my office because I am defamed in my office that I scared you away in 3 months. So now I really owe you big time for this.
No.
I don't know whether I deserve all the lovely things that you've said about me. But so far as reading is concerned, let me give you another confession. There are times when I actually don't complete a book. 90% of the time, I don't complete a book. And also, I read various books at the same time. Some books, again, this is a deep confession only for corridor law. There are some books which are meant for the loo. There are some books which are meant for the car. And there are some books which are meant for the court. And some books are meant everywhere. I found that we wasted a lot of time. Like someone told me in a party that you practice in the Delhi High Court. And I said, yes, I do. And that person said, I don't believe you because I've never seen you in the Delhi High Court canteen. And, you know, that was actually an eye-opener for me that, in fact, lawyers and many lawyers take the canteen very seriously. But for me, I realized that actually we have so much of spare time on our hand. And whether waiting for cases, commuting to court. So that's how the habit started of actually taking a book along and trying to read. And very soon I saw that people were noticing and then it gave a false sense of pride. And then I was under pressure to have a very good book every time because, you know, people would watch and take recommendations from what I'm reading. And one thing led to the other, and that's how this reading habit started. But yes, I don't regret it. And what to read for a lawyer, it's very personal. Some people like reading law stuff, like autobiographies of Lord Denning and Krishna Iyer and H.R. Khanna and all that. But that, you shouldn't feel pressurized to do that. I like, for example, reading graphic novels, historical works. So it's a potpourri of different things. Just inculcate the habit of reading, even if it be a few pages, buy a book whenever you want to invest instead of something which, a shirt. Maybe you can at times invest in a book. Even if you read a few pages and just leave it, at least that's there with you. That's there for keeps. And you can go back to it. And you never know. And I've used this personally so many times while you're arguing. You can actually bring in the information which you learn reading into your argumentation and take it at a completely different level. So it is always, I've always found it very, very profitable to actually read.
Exactly, sir. Also, there's a thought that anybody who asks for book recommendations is not really a reader. So, yeah. But yeah, that was again besides the point. I think we can start with the first topic of discussion here. The challenges first generation lawyers feel. So, could you please provide a background and your story firstly as to how you have gone about from being a first generation lawyer hailing from Kolkata and leading a life in New Delhi, completely new city for you, and setting up your practice here, to now fast forwarding to like probably more than 20 years and being a fearless senior advocate who seems to completely be unafraid to put himself out there, whether in sensitive cases or even digitally or even on social media for that matter. How is this? What is the story, sir? Like, what should we learn from that?
Well, to start with, let me tell you, one of the professors in law school, I went to the National Law School, Bangalore, and in our final year, one of the professors said that if you are now thinking that what you're going to specialize in, then you are the biggest fool, because you will not specialize in any law. You will do exactly the law which fate, destiny, and your clients take you to do. And actually, it's been a series of destiny, fate, coincidences. I graduated and I got the best job in campus. It was with a consulting firm, but that year they started this apprenticeship rule and you had to go through a 1 year of apprenticeship before you could become a full-fledged lawyer. The firm promised that they'll get it done. Obviously, they couldn't get it done. So I left that job in 9 months, Arthur Anderson, Bangalore. And I wanted a job. And at that time, no one in Calcutta would give a job. You know, it was like 400 rupees or 300 rupees was what they were paying. And I was very clear, at least some kind of basic subsistence wages I needed. And at that time, I was told that Indira Jaisingh, through a junior of mine who had interned with her, was willing to take a lawyer. And that's how it's only the 5,000 rupee salary which got the greedy me coming all the way to Delhi. And frankly, I had no idea of Indira's vast practice, reputation, or whatever it is, or the controversy, which ultimately I have been associated with and proudly associated with. But at that time, I had no idea. It's simply the fact that in Calcutta, no damn lawyer was willing to pay 5,000 rupees to a junior fresher. And here was this lady who was willing to give it. And that's what got me to Delhi. And I was very clear that I will work for a year. I had my grandmother in Delhi. So at least my boarding and lodging was taken care of, which is difficult for other first timers and people who come to Delhi from outside, you know, and who don't have rich parents to bankroll their stay and their working. Because obviously, even now, the salaries which seniors pay or senior lawyers, litigators in the litigation is woefully inadequate. Imagine. In most offices, the clerk earns more than the junior lawyer who's been through, let's say, 5 years of a national law school and spent lakhs in education. He gets a salary of 20,000 where he can't barely pay his mobile phone bill and barely survive without some kind of assistance from parents, let alone pay back the education loans. Well, I would simply say, so far as I am concerned, I got lucky. And I can say with pride that after I graduated, I've never taken a penny from my parents. And that was my focus. Live within your means and ensure that you never have to be ever dependent on your parents. But yes, it is tough. I will not sugarcoat it. For a first generation lawyer, the legal profession is very, very hierarchic. It is very oligarchic. It is very, very clannish. For an outsider to come and even survive is a very, very difficult thing. And I truly feel blessed that I've been able to at least survive in so many years.
So, but it definitely has more to do with more than luck, I feel. My next question was actually going to be, what are the obstacles in pursuing a career in litigation? But I would actually like to ask, how much would luck really determine, and what kind of skills or traits do you feel like you can develop in law school and also beyond that as a young professional to get rid of these obstacles? Because I'm sure like you've already covered some of these obstacles already, but there is obviously like a lot more to do than just luck, I feel. It has a lot to do with just persevering and hard work, I guess. There is something else, like for sure, it's like a way of life, I feel. And I feel like the best of the litigators, whether first generation lawyers or even otherwise, just have something that they understand, which is not understood by every first generation lawyer. So like, what are the skills that help you get rid of these obstacles that come in the way?
Well, I don't want to get into the usual the law is a jealous mistress kind of patriarchal stuff which is always doled out, but there is a saying that who said law is a bed of roses is either beds or it is roses, meaning that it's either you're sleeping or you're working hard without sleep and you're getting the roses or reaping the fortune. So basically it means there's only one secret for success, and that is hard work. And you have to put it in. Unfortunately, again, this may be a generational thing which I'm seeing. When you grow old, you start seeing these generational differences. I find that the coming generations are losing their patience. They want to, make it very fast. But unfortunately, law requires a lot of gestational investment. You just can't get quick returns because of the circumstances in which how the legal practice, especially litigation, works out. Until you build a reputation, until people actually come to you, until judges listen to you, until you're able to deliver. As my senior once said, you're as good as your last order. You may be a top lawyer in the country, but if you stop getting orders for your clients, you are past your sell-by date. So what is the X factor? I don't know. But I can say that everyone has it in them to find their own place in litigation. Everyone does not have to be an arguing counsel. Everyone does not, you can be a solicitor, you can be a researcher, you can be a manager of a law office. You can find a career in the judiciary ultimately. So everyone, I know a lot of lawyers who may not have had very good legal reputation as a litigator. But when appointed in the high courts and in other courts, they've turned out to be superb judges. So you never know, you know, as you were talking about your talent. I mean, look at the wonderful thing that you are doing. You, Anirudh, and all of you are doing with Corridor Law. I mean, I was just discussing with a fellow senior advocate friend of mine that I think this is a very bold initiative that you're taking, and it requires a lot of courage and guts to think out of the board, out of the box, and to take this risk and not follow the herd and do exactly what everyone else is doing. So this is what I mean, that find your mojo, find what is it that makes you different, what is it that gives you that passion. And as I told you so many years ago when you first came to my chamber, when you hit it, you will know exactly that this is it. Like, I have never had a minute's doubt that the litigation is exactly what I wanted to do. I was miserable every day of my life when I was in that consulting job and, you know, writing out these fancy reports for these fancy MNCs. But I realized that that is not me. That is not what I want to do. I want to be in court. I want the thrill of litigating. I want the thrill of a judge appreciating the courtroom, noticing, and the client being happy that you've been able to deliver. Right? So yes. I really can't, you know, pinpoint and say it is this X factor which makes you different. Everyone has a different X factor. And you have to find that X factor in you.
Yes, sir. I feel like that mojo bit is, I think, very important. Like, unless that you find it exciting, I don't know, like, if I ever found it exciting personally. What I did want to do was fit in, because that is what I wanted to do in law school. But beyond that, like, yeah, maybe business of law is where we are at, and business as a course was never as interesting. Law is the best thing to read, and consultancy may be like boring for some people, but consultancy and watching businesses grow is like really exciting for me now. Helping everybody like in marketing or figuring out their niche online, learning about digital marketing, etc. It seems like very new. It comes very naturally. So you're absolutely right. Like I don't know, like personally, like the thrill of litigation. So what is it really about? Like I couldn't understand it. But like what excites you about litigation the most? As a, this is away from the first generation lawyer bit, sorry. But apart from the validation, apart from the thrill itself, like what is it that really is exciting about litigation? Just as a like a practical concept, like when you're hands on with it.
Okay, let me try to answer this in a different way. Yeah. One of my best friends from National Law School is one of the senior most in-house lawyers of Wipro. And he one day said that, I just want to come one day to court and see how litigation is. And he came with me, and within a few hours, he said, I don't know how you can do this daily. You know, this kind of wasting of time, this kind of standing in the corridors, this kind of having bun samosas in the canteen. It was a nightmare for him. Because he is used to the culture of every minute counts, preparing the data sheets, etc. Well, when I was younger, I would look down on that kind of work that he did. But now, as I realize, you know, when you become old, you become tamer, you, if not wiser. And I realize that, you know, it is not for us to judge. Sure, there is a lot of inefficiency in litigation. But, you know, we have seen during the pandemic, one of the best things that has happened during the pandemic is the way lawyers have embraced technology, which has really improved the efficiency of even litigation. So there are, you know, it is, if I now start saying how great litigation is as opposed to a non-lit career, it might be very, very presumptuous of me. And I don't want to go from that point of trying to denigrate or run down something else. But so far as for me, my experience has been, I started off, of course, now I'm doing a lot of commercial arbitration, because I've always maintained that if you're a good lawyer, you can do anything. And there is this tendency, and let me put it on record, of trying to label people. Are ye to human rights wale hai, ye activist lawyer hai, ye worker ka lawyer hai. And that is, you know, unfortunate, because if you're a good lawyer, you can be as comfortable doing an infrastructure arbitration involving thousands of crores, which I, for example, one I did yesterday, and then come today in the morning and appear in the high court for a little girl who's not being paid her maintenance by her father. You should be equally comfortable in doing both kinds of law. So for me, when I started off, I was more in the individual law rather than the corporate law, which came over time because of the papi pate, as they say. But the satisfaction of actually being able to give a concrete result to a human flesh and bone client, it is priceless, you know, like the MasterCard ad. Everything has a price, and this is priceless. The joy that you see in a client. I can tell you, for example, one of my biggest friends is a lady whose daughter was almost going to lose her entire future because her passport had been cancelled. And almost 15 years ago, I fought a writ petition on her behalf, of course, filed by the mother. And we got the government to direct a passport to be given to her because her mother was a single mother and she wanted to take the child outside India. And she today is a graduate from the US and she's working in India. And it was, you know, I dare say, of course, it's the role of the judge, her destiny. But I did play a small part in this whole process of making a difference in someone's life. And, you know, that itself is a reward. You don't need any recognition. I mean, I will not sit and start counting what I have got and what I have not got. But that itself is a reward. That itself is a reward.
Yes, sir. I just come back to the topic at hand, actually, which is something around the issues and pain points and struggles and challenges associated with being a litigator. For somebody who does not have a family or mentor or a godfather in the in the practice. Now, like, what are the ways that can, like, what are the actionable points, actually? Like, not a mantra type of a thing. There's no X factor that can actually help you out of it. That was more like a skill that maybe you can acquire over a period of time. But yeah, like, what can someone in this situation do? What is the script? Like, what can you write for yourself if you're in this situation?
See, I can tell you one thing, and I'm not going to beat around the bush. A mentor is a very important thing. A godfather, maybe a crude way of putting it, but you need a Sherpa in the litigation profession, unfortunately. And you can, you know, what better way to give an example to those people who are upset that they don't have mentors is to give the example of Muhammad Ali Jinnah, one of our greatest Indian lawyers, unfortunately went on to be the founder of Pakistan thereafter. But I'm talking about when he was a patriotic nationalist Indian lawyer in the Bombay High Court, and his junior MC Chagla was very upset with him because once a client of his came and said, can you recommend this Chagla to handle the small case, which I also had, and I don't want to trouble you with this big case, with this small case because you're such a big lawyer. And Jinnah said, no, I will not let my chamber junior do this matter. And MC Chagla writes in his autobiography that at that stage, I was very, very upset with Jinnah, with my senior, and I didn't understand why he wasn't encouraging me. And he says, ultimately, later in life, I realized that Jinnah wanted me to be self-sufficient. Of course, this is like an Ekalavya, Dronacharya kind of very, very idealistic thing. It sounds good when spoken, but it's difficult in practice. But it is, but this is, of course, earlier you had privilege. And I can see a little difference was made with NLUs coming in. Then we may not have had family, but we came from reputed national law universities. And that itself became a kind of a, class status, which got us those doors open. But how many people can go to NLUs? So you still have a limited number of people who come from these established oligarchic families of judges and senior lawyers or solicitors. And then you have these NLU brigade who may be first generation, but at least they have an NLU tag. But we are talking about hundreds and hundreds of other people who don't have any of this. And for them, sadly, it is very, very difficult to make a break. And I can tell you, during the pandemic, my heart broke when I found that so many lawyers were reduced to destitution and poverty. People were actually reaching out and, asking for even small sums like 5,000-10,000 rupees. And it must have been so demeaning for lawyers, professionals, degree holders to actually be reduced to that level. And that is another debate for another day of how to improve the system. But yes, I feel that there has been very less of mentoring which is done, very less of investing in the junior bar. The disproportionate amounts that lawyers earn over time they do not plow it back to help and mentor their young lawyers who may not have had the good fortune of having a background.
I actually recall an incident like in court where someone, I think you had scolded me for something that I couldn't understand at all at the time. And someone else like literally came walking from far away and probably saw me demoralized or in whatever condition after that and told me this is a gift. Like your senior is investing time in you in the middle of court, like telling you whatever he is for 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Whatever it is, like this is a gift. Like, do not be demoralized. You just have to take it in the right way. This is what mentorship probably like looks like in litigation. But also, like generally speaking, sir, like, is there a way to solve for this? Is there a way to solve for this through, through technology, through solutions, like, or is it just how relationships are based in litigation? Like
now, people will say that I have been paid to promote corridor law, but I think this is exactly what you guys are trying to do. All the best to you. Because corridor law, what I understand from you people, the concept is you want to encourage lawyers with no connections, no backgrounds to pool in their resources, to find the links, find the mutual strength. And all the best to you. And this needs to be done. This needs to be done at one level, because if you're going to wait for the institution to reform the way we see judicial appointments happen, the way we see the Bar Council function, that it's a long, long road. That will not happen. So you better, as they say, Atmanirbhar, you better become self-reliant. And young lawyers should pool in their resources and try to help themselves. You know, I dare say you can't unionize. Lawyers can't form trade unions. And of course, we have the bar associations for that. But then again, bar associations are dominated by the seniors in the bar, right? And who have an interest in promoting the status quo. They are not going to be so concerned about, the needs of the junior bar. And somehow the junior bar also doesn't realize what an effective constituency it is. You are actually a substantial constituency. But unfortunately, because of the nature of the legal profession, and you are so pisoed with each of your chambers that you are unable to realize your collective strength.
Yes, sir. No, beyond just corridor.law also, like, is there a way? But yeah, I think coming together is like one part of it. Beyond that, people kind of need to be open to being mentored, and that is something that I feel.
Tushar, I'm sorry, I'm interrupting you because I might lose this thought. You know, one important thing you must understand, and this applies at every level, from the young lawyer to the senior advocate to the judges, there is enough space for everyone under the sun. This is a huge profession. Everyone has space. And you can fight for your space. You can establish your space. So the first thing is stop being insecure. And the second thing is reach out and help your colleagues. And that is how you build networks, and that is how you build these partnerships. If you start fighting, if you start being insecure, then you're not going to have these partnerships. You're not going to be able to network. You're not going to be able to self-mentor. For example, a simple thing like, you're starting off all of you. You may be working in an insolvency resolution-based office practice. Someone may be working in a labor law-based practice. Someone may be working in a matrimonial law-based practice. So when you have you as a young lawyer, you may not have the skills on all these things. So tomorrow, when let us say you've got a matrimonial case, you may not want to give up that case, but you may want some kind of assistance, some kind of pep talk, some kind of inputs. So that's when your colleague who is doing this practice should reach out to you, and vice versa. When your matrimonial colleague needs something, then you can reach out. That's how you build these bridges, you build these associations, these linkages.
That's a great point about insecurity, sir. Like, I feel like, yeah, like a lot of people get into a mode of trying to be like very either complacent or insecure around their existence. I think you've like mentioned this various times, and I feel, yeah, like this is a point, like, I feel, yeah, young people, probably like me included, everybody should keep that in mind. Just generally speaking, sir, I like maybe we've covered this earlier, but So what would you say are the skills and qualities and traits that are needed to be a litigator? Like if you could just list out things that you feel are very important, like as skills and qualities.
The most important quality, though I hate these lists, creating these lists, but you repeatedly come back to lists, I guess it works. The most important quality is observe. And this observation continues forever. And I see a lot of young lawyers who will, the moment their case is over, they'll come out and they'll be on their mobile, checking their Insta and their Facebook or Twitter, or chatting with their colleagues and having their tea and going to the canteen. I'm not opposed to that. But what I'm saying is, a lot of times stay back in the courtroom. I have seen my juniors who, even if we don't have the cases or our cases are over, they still stay back in the virtual court now in the pandemic and they hear the proceedings. A lot is learned from seeing and observing proceedings. That's why we say practice. Right? Yeah, we are practicing law, right? So therefore, keep your eyes and ears open. A lot of skills you'll pick up. For example, let's say you have a case before a judge. Don't just go in when your matter is coming up. Go early and observe the judge. See how he or she is dealing with every case. Understand what kind of arguments will appeal to that judge. See how lawyers are reacting before that judge. And that's how you build your institutional knowledge. And that's how you develop your practice. That's how you become a confident lawyer. That's a fundamental thing. And the other thing, of course, as I said, is you have to have the patience. You have to have the staying power. I know it's easier said than done, but it is important that you should give all your full best to it.
Sure. Yes, sir. This is actually quite related to the previous question. Actually, it's not a list, but yeah, lists actually work best for the internet consumption anyway. So this question is around emotional aspects, the emotional and mental, probably like what are the emotional, mental, physical, logistical, financial aspects that a first generation lawyer has to deal with? Especially
if I knew all of that, then I would have a huge practice. I'm a struggling lawyer, as I say in Twitter. So you're asking a very heavy question.
So that's a positional genius. that's actually like great marketing from a legal professional. That's a positional genius, but it's actually probably not even like, it's probably divided into too much, I feel here, but more on the lines of the emotional side, like.
Yes, emotional. Let me tell you, what is the most important thing is that you have to understand that we are the only profession. Of course, there are others also. A Bollywood actor does the same thing. A Bollywood actor has a matinee release once every, let's say, 4 or 5 months, right? If he's lucky or she's lucky. We as lawyers have our matinee release every day. You go out, so your matinee is your court. You go out every day and in public, when everyone is watching you, you put yourself out. You do your performance in front of everyone. And that requires a lot of mental strength. That requires a lot of guts and grit. And people don't understand. The non-lawyers make fun of us. Oh, what is the big deal? Doctors are working, engineers are working, architects are working. Why do you need your holidays? Because it is mentally exhausting, which is why we need that kind of breaks also. Because every day, and you're as I said, you're as good as that last order. So you have the pressure. Of course, as a senior, as you grow old, let me tell you, I still have butterflies in my stomach. And that's how it should be. You can't be so confident and say that, now I know it all and I don't need to have the pressure of performance. It is always there and it's good to have it. But the most important thing is you need to build a thicker skin. If judges scold you, if your senior scolds you, as you outed me just now a few minutes back in public, take it in that.
I remember it fondly.
Yes.
Exactly. It's hard to take it rightly in the moment is something that I can clarify here, but definitely retains in a greater space, like in the long run, like in the mind, like I feel like I go back to that moment when I have to push myself a little bit. I have like no problem with taking strength from that moment in a good way, like not in a bad way ever.
Right, right.
So I think if we have lesser time, maybe we can go to the next like substantial point, which is how young lawyers should actually go about building their practice, especially first generation lawyers who have no support or anybody to like really have a practice around, like to build on.
So I'll tell you how Gopal Subramaniam ji, of course he's not told me directly, but I've heard, or Harish Salve, the biggest bigs that you have in the profession, started. They would do cases for free, argue for free, or for very, very minimal fees. So as a young lawyer, don't be picky and choosy. Do whatever you get. Offer to volunteer to go and, you know, handle your friend's case for free. That gives you the exposure, that gives you the confidence, that gives you the court visibility. So that's one thing. Don't be money-minded. I know it's easier said than done. I know it's easy for a senior advocate who's making decent money to tell young lawyers, don't be money-minded. But believe me, there is a purpose and method in what I'm saying, because we all go through that process. So don't focus on the money. If you think that you're getting less or you're getting cheated, short change, doesn't matter. You're also getting that brief. You're also getting that visibility. So do that. That is the most important thing, advice I would give young lawyers. And also don't be demoralized. If a client leaves you and goes to another lawyer, if you have a bad day in court, if people judge you from which law school you come, or you know how you speak English, or you have difficulty in the dress you're wearing or the way you're speaking, don't let any of this get to you. Don't let anyone tell you that you are not good enough, because you are. Because as I keep saying, that if I can do it, anyone can do it.
That's a great answer, sir. Thank you for that. Can we talk about something like specifically that you just said, that let's say if you're not getting paid, are there ways to still do something to have some money on the side, which is maybe just drafting, or in the modern world now, drafting agreements or putting some kind of skills to use while you're also
as a matter of fact, I think senior advocates should allow their juniors to also have some seniors don't allow it. But senior advocates should allow their juniors to also have individual practice and, you know, earn some money if you're not adequately compensating or not in a position to adequately compensate. And now the opportunities are so much. Like someone can offer to host a show for you on Corridor Law, and you can, you know, pay a stipend to that person. Right? So, you know, opportunities are increasing for lawyers.
Exactly. Yeah. How would you say, sir, like generally, I think you are someone who has established a great presence online. How would you say, how important is that? And does that really help in getting your first client or increasing your clientele? Or does it have nothing to do with that?
For me, it's on the contrary. I can tell you, an instructing lawyer just called me the other day and said, sir, will you please change that struggling lawyer bio? Because we are trying to sell you as a senior advocate, and the clients keep checking on the net and they say that ye to struggling lawyer hai, iske paas kyun jayenge? And I say that, no, I'm sorry, the struggle is a struggle for life. I don't need clients, but I wear that as a badge of honor. And I, frankly, I was quite pleasantly surprised. I was approached 2 weeks back by someone who wanted to pay me for tweets. So, you know, I said that, see, I don't do this. For me, social media is for stress release. It is for fun. And also it is to have the voice of the voiceless heard. I'm not here for visibility and publicity and to improve my career. Maybe that can be a legitimate option for people. I'm not judging them, but I'm not here for that. I don't need to be on Twitter to be able to, put some bread and grub on my table, my family's table.
This is another important question, actually, that personally, like, I have already like decided to do Corridor.law as a full-time thing. And it is like, it is the normal business. It's just that we are dealing with the market, which comprises of lawyers. But what would you say generally, like people feel like giving up every day, every other day. And I feel like a lot of them are first generation lawyers. I know, like, I have sort of done that, but I've also figured out that I wanted to do something else. And I did practice for a couple of years. And the IBC example, actually, that you were giving, it was great to like just pick up the act one day and start reading it. And like, I had no clue, like I could understand stuff like that. But yeah, like it did work out. It just seemed like this was better. And this is where my mojo lied at. So I quit because I found something better. But generally, people feel like giving up every other day, as especially first generation lawyers. Yes, how can one choose to not, or when should they? What would you say about that?
Well, you know, it is very easy for me to say don't give up. but I know the conditions in which everyone has to function. And this pandemic has even worsened the conditions of younger lawyers. It is very difficult, you know, especially when you get married, you have children, you have family, you have old parents, you have obligations. It's very, very difficult to take that call. You know, I really don't know what to say. I really don't know. I wish I could give you some kind of, excellent answer, but I have no answer, and that's the truth. And therefore, the truth is that it is your inner sense which you have to rely on, and your inner conscience is the best guide. Because trust me, no one knows you better than yourself, and you will know that this is not happening. And but again, don't go by the first impulse. When the moment you think, oh, maybe I'm not fit for this, that is not the time to go. That is not the time to quit. There are many people who've had this impulse, who left and they came back and they were excellent lawyers. And I need not tell you, the father of the nation bombed as a lawyer in Bombay, and ultimately he was a rock star for lawyer in South Africa. He had a substantial practice because he tweaked it and he realized that he needs to be in a foreign country and market himself as a lawyer for Indian clientele. And he did well. So you never know. Maybe at times also there's this pressure to come to the cities, but this is also something you should consider. Maybe not, city life is not for all. When I say city, I mean metropolitan cities. You can go back to your, let's say tier two or three city, or even in your town and practice law. Today, the world is integrated. You have VCs. You can attend Supreme Court sitting in Bulandshahr, right? Or Gorakhpur. So you don't need to rush and be in Delhi. That cuts a lot of your costs. That cuts a lot of these inhibitors which are there in your way. And also, if you come to the city, big cities, and you get trained and you take that expertise back to the districts, remember, you become the king over there. So you become the person. Here you are amongst a galaxy of other people, but when you take it back to your small towns or to the districts, you then, you know, are the pioneer over there. So consider that also. But again, as I said, these are very individual decisions. I can't sit here and give some gyan on these issues. It is very, very personal.
Sure, sir. Another like a parallel thing I want to ask you is, what is a lawyer-client relationship like when you're younger? And how does it change over the years? Is it,
Again, this is very personal.
Yes.
Some people are still very, very passionate about their clients. Some people are never passionate even to start off with. But the general, you can go by the general trend that the older you go, the less passionate or the less, even today as a senior advocate, at times when I don't get an order for a client, I do feel bad. I mean, I'm not that evolved that I say, okay, it's a brief. I've been paid. Let me move on. Even when my briefing lawyer will call and say, sir, you did your best. And actually, we had a shit case. Even then, I feel bad. But over time, you realize that your client has his own destiny or her own destiny. And the lawyer-client relationship evolves wherein ultimately exactly what happens, which is expected in the bar, that you become the officer of the court as you are known more amongst the judges, amongst fellow lawyers, you develop a reputation, right? Then you don't, you have to think about that reputation also. And you can't just simply, go by what your client needs. You have to also balance that factor.
If I could ask you, like, would you like as a younger lawyer, would you have appreciated a platform that was connecting lawyers generally and bringing together things like all kinds of stakeholders together on one platform, even a mobile app? Does that even make sense?
If there were social media when I was in college, I'm fully confident that I would be in jail. So thank God. Not that I'm not confident even now, but thank God at least it's come late. But yes, on a serious side, yes, I believe that I would have benefited from a kind of an app or a kind of a platform like what you propose to do. I don't know how successful you'll be, but I wish you all the best. But yes, this is certainly something which would have been of use to me as a younger lawyer.
Sure. Okay. Thank you, sir. I think we could stop here.
Okay. Thank you so much. It was great chatting with you, Tushar. And
it was really good chatting with you.
I am going to use your confessional statement. And I hope it's a 164 statement and not a 161 statement. Because I don't look like a police officer from any angle. And this is going to be used in my office to tell people that I did not scare you away, as I'm told I'm defamed by my staff.
Oh, no, not at all. Not at all. It was more down to me, actually. I should have persevered a little bit more. And yeah, like, I think, yeah, this conversation was anyway pending for a while. So yes. I'm very happy that we
had. And how luck would have it, we've done it publicly.
it's a thing to be learned from. I think a lot of people would have faced this. So I hope, yeah, like, this can help. Like, the perspective itself is what I would like to push out. That's all.
Chalo, take care. Have a good evening. Thank you so much for having me.
Good evening, sir. Take care. Bye.
Good evening. Bye.